but now being made free from sin. That's what we just got to be thinking about. Praise God. Being made free from sin and become servants to God, you have your fruit unto holiness. And what's the end of that?
Everlasting life.
Everlasting life. Praise God. Let's pray. Lord, help us tonight as we study your word. We ask for grace. Touch our hearts. Oh God, let us, Lord Jesus, have within inside of our hearts, God, a thrust, a drive to be close to you. Oh, let your word, Lord, be planted in our hearts tonight. And I ask for grace, humbly, Lord, ask for grace, God, to minister to your people, because it takes you to do anything inside of us. It's not just in the power of any man, but it's by your spirit, oh God. Touch us now. Lord, we ask you to touch Sister Tatum. She's a part of us, God. We ask you to, Lord, lay your hand upon her and heal her body and these needs that she has in her life, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Everybody say, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You believe he heard you?
Yes.
Amen. Expect an answer. You can be seated. I want Brother Dingman. Praise God. I like what that says. We have everlasting life. Amen. When we have our fruit in the holiness, the end is everlasting life. You want to live forever?
Amen.
That's why I come to church. I want to live forever, don't you? It'd be, pretty sad if all that a person had to hope for was just this life.
Yeah.
Because you know what? I don't know how close I'm to the end of my days here, but you know, I'm a whole lot closer to it than I was when I started.
Yeah.
You know? Right? And there's some people that's been younger than me that has went on. And it would be sad to think that if all the life that I had was just today. Amen. Praise God. But I've got hope of everlasting life.
Yeah.
When I'm living for Jesus. Amen. When I got Jesus in my life, and you know, if there was ever a time for me to live for him, I really ought to do it now. You know, we ought to always live for him, but I ought to really, they say, put the pedal to the metal, you know, and do it with everything that I can do it with him. Within me. Amen. Because he has laid up for me a hope on the other side. Amen. Right?
Amen.
Think about that. Everlasting life. The John 3:16 is one of the most well-known scriptures probably amongst Christendom. You know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's what Jesus is about.
Amen.
Everlasting life. Another scripture says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, amen, the gift of God is eternal life. That's everlasting, eternal life through Jesus Christ. Amen. You know what the gift of God is, don't you? Uh-huh. Some would say, well, eternal life is the gift of God. It is the gift of God, but when it says everlasting life there in that scripture, the gift of God is eternal life. The gift of God is eternal life. You know what the gift of God is? The gift of God is the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Holy Ghost is given through Jesus. Amen. Amen. The Spirit is given to us. And when that Spirit is inside of us, I believe, if I understand the scriptures correctly, I think I do, but we have residing inside of us, when we are filled with the Holy Ghost, we have eternal life abiding inside of us.
Amen.
It's there.
Amen.
Remember what Jesus said? Amen. You know, he that believes on him has went from death to life.
Yeah.
Right then.
Yeah.
Right, eternal life has gone from death to life. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. I believe that. Praise God. That's why Christians often in the Bible, when it talked about them passing from this life, it said they fell asleep because they weren't looked upon as being dead. Yeah, the physical body died, but that inner man, that person that we are, you know, inside, we didn't die. We don't die. Well, Christian, we just exchange residence.
Yep.
We just leave that temporal house of the body, and we go to be with the Lord according to the Scripture.
Amen.
Amen. And that's that part of us. You ever been to a funeral and seen somebody that died? There's a part of them that's left.
Yep.
That is no longer there. Every person that has died has that eternal part of them. And I believe that there is an element to every one of us because we were made in the image of God. We were made in His image and in His likeness. I believe that there is in each one of us that spirit man that's inside of us, that spirit person of us is forever. It is eternal because God's eternal.
Yeah.
And we were made in His image and in His likeness. Not just in a physical sense, you know. Amen. We were made in His image and in His likeness. And I believe that there is eternity, you know. But with some people, it won't be eternal life. It'll be eternal damnation. Those that do not live for the Lord, it will be eternal damnation. The worm died not, and the fire is not quenched, you know? What Jesus mentioned. That's why Jesus came to this world. He came so that eternal part of us will end up with eternal life and not eternal damnation. Jesus came to let all the penalty of our sins be laid upon Him. Amen. So it doesn't have to be laid upon us. Amen. But every life without Jesus has that penalty upon them of eternal death. It has that penalty upon them. The only thing that will lift that is having it lifted and placed on Jesus. Amen. Praise God. And He gives unto those that believe in Him, as the Scripture says, it says, He gives unto them eternal life, everlasting life. What an awesome thing to possess, everlasting life. I want that. You know why? Because if I have that personally, I will live forever. But if my wife has it, she will live forever. And if my children have it, my children will live forever. And if you have it, you will live forever. And you know what will happen? There will be that glad reunion on the other side. Amen? Praise God. Isn't that wonderful?
Amen.
To think that, you know, when you lay to rest your loved ones, if they have Jesus inside of them, that is not all there is to it. You will see them again. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? You can't get that any place but in Jesus. Jesus is the only one that gives that. And you might think, well, Brother Abbott, that's pretty narrow-minded. But you know what? That's what Jesus said.
Amen.
Amen. He told them, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go away, I will come again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there you may be also. Right?
Amen.
And they said, was it Thomas, I think it was, said, you know, Lord, we don't know the way. And, you know, and Jesus said, I am the way.
Amen.
In other words, to get on the other side safely and actually have eternal life, Jesus is the way. Jesus Amen. Said, I am the door of the sheepfold. If any man enter in, amen. Praise God. He's going to have eternal life, isn't he?
Amen.
Come on. He shall be saved, he said. And that's what we're talking about, eternal life. Eternal life.
Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. But you know what we got to do? We got to be set free. That song. Look at that song. That scripture we read, but now being made free from sin and become servants to God. We are made free from sin. Jesus makes us free from sin.
Amen.
Huh? And we are to be, and we become servants to God. Amen. Now, we don't need to just be able to quote that. We need to put in practice that. Right?
Yeah.
Be made free from sin. Amen. Praise God. Look at that song. You get that song that they sang? Freedom. Look at the words to that song. I thought, man, what an awesome song to go. I didn't tell them to sing that song. That's just what they picked out to sing. I want to clap a little louder than before. Okay, go to the next one. No more shackles. Before I came to the Lord, I had shackles on me. I didn't have literal shackles. Amen. I have had handcuffs probably on me before I came to Jesus. Literal ones. You know?
Amen.
I've been in jail a few times. Before I knew Jesus, I told Brian today, hadn't been in there one time since Jesus got a hold of me. Amen. And so I could sing that song and literally no more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. But there's shackles, there's chains. You know, there's things that bind people. Many of the things that I was shackled with, that I was bound with, it wasn't literal chains. You know, but there were addictions in my life.
Yeah.
There were, you know, things that before I came to Jesus, amen, I had things that bound my life. You know, drinking, you can talk about drinking, smoking, dipping, you know, cussing, all those kind of things like that. But I also had other kind of things in my life. Like I had fear in my life.
Amen.
You know, I told Brian the other day, and I hate to even bring this up, but I told him the other day, you know, whenever I was in the world and was drinking and stuff, I've been in jail only four times, you know. Well, some of them have been in jail a lot of their life, you know, that come to the Lord. And I'm thankful, you know, that the Lord, no matter how many times you've been in there, He'll set you free, you know.
Amen.
But every time that I got put in jail, with exception of one time, there was violence involved in it.
Amen.
Accompanying, I'm talking on my part.
Yeah.
You know, alcohol made me a violent person.
Amen.
Or I give myself to it, you know. And it just kind of goes hand in hand. Not everybody's like that, but a lot of people are like that. And I never was a drug user or anything like that. But I did do the alcohol thing. And it got me in a lot of trouble. But that's not the only thing that I was bound with. I was bound with, one time, when I was in sin still, one time I watched a tornado kill some people. Okay? I watched the tornado. I didn't literally see the people get killed, but I was watching the tornado that killed them. And I was just sitting there watching it. And this was before I knew Jesus. Okay? And I was watching that thing, and after I saw that and the damage and the people being killed, and just, oh my goodness, there is a spirit that got a hold of me. And I feared. You wouldn't believe how horrible it was. It sounds silly to me now to even have something like that so engulfing my life, you know. I got to the point, if it got to be even a little, you know, drizzly looking, I started looking in the clouds, searching. I just nearly was out of panic. I'm serious. You know, I don't know why that so traumatized me, other than I personally believe that there was a spirit attached to it. You know, spirit took advantage of a time to enter my life and bind me. It's a horrible thing to be bound with the spirit of fear.
Amen. That's right.
It is horrible.
Amen.
And some people, when you can have a, you know, there's all kinds of things that can enter in people's lives. And because of the way I lived prior to coming to the Lord, I went through a phase, and I'm just telling you, I was ridiculously jealous. That's before I was married Sister Ratliff. I was ridiculously, I couldn't help it. I was tormented. I look at it now, it's so crazy, you know, to think. But you know what? Again, there was a spirit, I believe, that took an opportunity, amen, and took occasion at making and being able to enter my life when I was totally ignorant of spirit things.
Yeah.
That there are things that take occasions in your life to enter your life, and you can't shake it.
Yeah. Amen.
You cannot shake it. Some people it's drugs. You know, some people it's immorality.
Amen.
You know, because toying with porn or something like that. You know, and they become habitual. Come on. And they can't shake it and they can't put it away. Because a spirit takes opportunity on the occasion and enters a person's life. Amen.
Amen.
Don't think that they can't. Spirits can even get in children.
Amen.
They can. They did. They brought a boy to Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, the disciples tried to get the spirit out of him. And they couldn't because of their unbelief. You know? And they brought him to, the man brought him to Jesus and said, you know, I brought him to your disciples. They couldn't get him out. And they said, how long ago has this come upon him? Of a child? Of a child. Something entered his life as a child.
Amen.
And it overcame him and put something inside of his life that made him, you know, act the way that he did. You know, there are spirits coming on. Large, different categories. A lot of things. A lot of times they're masked.
Yes, they are.
They're masked. Where you think it's a physical thing. Every physical thing is not necessarily spirit.
That's right.
You understand? You can walk out in the cold, in the rain, and you can catch a cold. That don't mean you got a spirit in you.
Yeah.
You know? But there are things, and in the medical world doesn't believe in that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But there are things that have entered people's lives, amen, that need to be removed from their lives, and they can be removed from their lives through Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage. Amen. Through Jesus. Amen. I am free.
Amen.
You know what? When I came to Jesus, that fear left me.
Amen.
Come on. That jealousy left
Amen.
Me. All of that stuff. All that alcohol. All of that, you know, all those things, habits, addictions. Whenever the Lord brought this guy right here to repentance. Amen. I talked about it several times. But there's a lot of things that left my life whenever I turned to Jesus.
Amen.
When real repentance was in my heart.
Amen.
It takes real repentance. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. And it didn't take a long time. And I didn't know everything about God.
Amen.
But what I did do is I asked God to forgive me.
Amen.
And I totally let go of all of the way I was living. And I turned to Him. And I want you to know something. Even before I received the Holy Ghost, He set me free from those things.
Yes.
I haven't touched alcohol no more.
Amen.
I took a little NyQuil. But as far as drinking that beer and all that stuff, I haven't been to another nightclub.
Amen.
Come on. I haven't touched any more snuff. Amen.
Amen.
I was in my 20s whenever the Lord got a hold of me. I haven't touched any more of it.
Amen.
He took the foul language out of me.
Amen.
Come on.
Thank
he
you.
Took the immorality out of me. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. He took all that filth and all that garbage. I'm telling you something. He set this guy free. He set me free. And I'm still free.
Amen.
I'm still free from
Amen.
Those things. And I tried my best to get rid of a lot of those things before Jesus, and I never could do it.
Amen.
I'm telling you, He sets us free. I was the servant of sin. But now I've been set, made free from sin, and I have become a servant to God. Have you?
Amen.
Come on. We got to do that. Amen. You'll never be free from sin unless you depart from it.
Amen.
You've got to make that, there's got to be that repentance in your life.
Amen.
Jeremiah was just preaching about repentance.
Yes.
Amen. There's got to be that turn, an actual, not just being, you know, Christian-y.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people goes to churches, but they never have truly repented. They keep living the same way they've always lived.
Amen.
Because they don't, oftentimes they don't hear a voice that tells them that they must turn. You know? I wasn't even going to church when I repented. I wasn't listening to radio preachers. I wasn't going to church. Amen. I have not been darkening the doors of a church. I had not even been wanting to go to church. The Lord just brought the realization to my heart that I was in sin.
Amen.
And I needed to get out of sin and give my life to Him.
Amen.
I did that at my home by myself. Nobody was, you know, tagging me on the, nobody was talking to me. Nobody was witnessing to me. God got a hold of my heart and made me realize I was in a very dangerous place.
Amen.
In the life that I was living. And I repented. Amen.
Amen.
Without even knowing that word existed.
Amen.
I didn't even know that the word existed.
Yeah.
Amen. I just knew I needed to change.
Amen.
And you know what? I told you this. I just went and bought me 3 brand new cans of Copenhagen. I did Copenhagen. I'd eat with it in my mouth. I'd done it for years. Drank stuff with it. I didn't want to spit it out. And yeah, I would. And smoked right along it. But, you know, but whenever the Lord did it to me, I went open. Now, nobody preached to me, told me that was wrong. No. I knew that it wasn't right.
Yeah.
You understand? Nobody was telling me that was wrong. My conscience told me. It did. And I went and I opened it up and I dumped it in the trash. 3 brand new cans. 3 brand new cans. Dumped it out. That was the end of that. That was the end of it all. Amen. And you know what? Massive changes took place. And it was all because of Jesus.
Amen.
It was, I didn't know a lot about Jesus. I picked this right here up.
Amen.
And it was like reading a foreign language at first. I saw that red print and finally got into that. And that's when it really picked up.
Yep.
And conviction started picking up. After a while, I decided to go to church somewhere.
Yep.
You know, I needed to. I kept feeling like I needed to. That was God talking to me.
Yeah.
You know, everybody needs to go to church. They need to go to a church that's preaching the truth, too.
Amen.
I didn't have any idea, any clue. I didn't know nothing about the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Didn't know nothing about being baptized in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Didn't know none of that stuff. But my folks went to a church. My grandmother. I didn't go. You know, I wasn't raised going. But I decided because it was a little church. It was about as big as this group here tonight. You know, it was just a small church. And I wanted to go to church. I felt like I needed to go to church. And so I went. And, you know, I kept going. And nobody was preaching about some things, you know, that I started feeling convicted about the more I got into this right here. The more I read this right here, the more I realized there were things I still needed to turn away from still. You know what? I'm continuing, even today, I'm looking for more. Are you looking for more? Because the more you see this and the more you do this, the more you're closer you're getting to Jesus.
You feel farther, though.
Amen.
Huh? Sometimes when you read it more, you feel farther.
Oh, yeah, sometimes. It just,
you get
it shows us. Yeah. Amen. I've said this before, just going off what Brian just said, you know, but I can see everybody in this place. I can see all of you. I can tell, you know, things about Sister Dean in there. That her glasses are golden looking. Their rims, and you know.
Yeah.
If I can see, you have blue eyes? Hazel eyes? I'm just not good on film color. I can see Jeremiah's got kind of dark hair. I can see that, but you know what? I can't see my hair. And I can't see my glasses. The rim.
Yeah.
I can pull them off and look at them. But to see me, I got to go to the mirror.
Yeah, that's right.
You know? And I can look in the mirror and see me. And that's what the Bible is.
That's right.
It shows me me. It shows me things. Amen. Praise God. And it's always showing me things. It helps me get closer and closer to God.
Yes, it does.
There's times it convicts my heart.
Amen.
It does convict my heart. But it doesn't condemn my heart.
Amen.
It doesn't condemn my heart unless I walk contrary to it.
Amen.
When I walk contrary to it and unwilling, I will feel condemned.
Amen.
But if it convicts me, the Lord deals with us to help us get closer to Him.
Yes.
You got to understand, God doesn't need any improvement. He doesn't need any improvement. It's me that needs improvement. Amen?
Amen.
And if God is absolutely perfect, for me to get closer to Him, I've got to get rid of some of my flaws.
Amen.
All right? Draw near to God, and He'll draw near to you. And He's good, and He's gentle, and He's kind, and He's long-suffering. And I became one of His children, and so did you if you gave your life to Him. We're His children, and He loves us. Amen? He wants us to make it, doesn't He? Praise God. I was the servant of sin. Amen. But I changed sides. Praise God. I don't want to be the servant of sin. In other words, I serve sin. I lived to sin before. Amen. But Jesus got my attention. And He turned me. Amen. I'm not here just to preach about myself. I'm saying it as well for you. Amen.
Amen.
Every one of us. That what He does for us. He wants us to become servants to Him. Because if He can get us from the life of sin and get us about face to serving Him, and we become service to God, you're going to start producing fruits that are holy.
Amen.
Godly.
Amen.
Righteous. In other words, the actions, the deeds, the things that you do in your life, the end of those things, when you live after that manner for Jesus, amen, the end of that is everlasting life. Amen. I want to go to heaven, don't you?
Amen.
Oh, I want to go to heaven. Praise God. Amen. If Jesus, He is the only way to go to heaven. Amen.
Amen.
And His life, the way He wants us to live, it leads us to that path. One place in the Old Testament, in Isaiah, it said that there would be a highway.
Yeah.
And it would be called the highway of holiness. Amen. And no fool would err therein, but the redeemed of the Lord shall walk therein. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Everlasting life. Amen. Praise God. We're free from sin, and we become the servants of God. And in being the servants of God, we start bearing different fruit. You know, a tree, the life that it has inside of it, produces the fruit that's on its limbs, right?
Amen.
Praise God. The life source, amen, the sap, you might say, the life, the, I don't know if you'd call it DNA or what, but the life's blood of that tree, if it's an apple, the life of it produces apples.
Yeah.
Amen. A banana tree is the same thing. You don't have the life of a banana in a tree and have it bear oranges. Amen. It bears what the life source is inside of it. And our God, if He's inside of our life, if He's actually inside of us, what should be being produced from our life are things that are attributes of Him. Is that right?
Amen.
Praise God. Let's look at Romans chapter 8, verse number 11. Praise God. Now, when we talk about the Spirit, we're talking about the Holy Spirit of God. We call it the Holy Ghost in the King James Version Bible. Amen. Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost, that's the same thing. That's that Spirit that Jesus puts inside of us whenever he baptizes us with his Spirit. Amen. But the Bible says in Romans 8 and verse number 11, Jeremiah also used the scripture, I believe, the other day. It says, but if the Spirit, amen, the Spirit, praise God. When he's talking about the Spirit, now, you got a human spirit. Every one of us got a human spirit. We're each individuals, aren't we? Everybody in this place. In fact, at death, your spirit comes out of your body. Right?
Amen.
Amen. Your spirit looks out of those eyes. Amen. It's housed inside of a body. Amen. Job said, thou hast fenced me with sinew and bones. Fenced him. I think of the rib cage and all that stuff. You know, we are a spirit being inside of a body of clay. And our body turns back to dust, doesn't it?
Amen.
Come on. Praise God. But when we're talking about the Spirit here, amen, we're not talking about our human spirit, our human part. In fact, when we get the Holy Ghost, what we want to do is through the blood of Jesus, through the sacrifice of Jesus, we need to call upon the Lord. We need to make an about face and turn to the Lord with all our hearts. Right?
Amen.
And ask God to put his Spirit, which God is a Spirit, put his Spirit into us. What happens is because of the blood of Jesus, and we repent, he will come and he will marry up to our spirit.
Amen.
The Bible says, he that's joined to the Lord is one spirit. It's like a marriage. It is. Two people get married, and they too become one flesh, right? Amen. What God does, when he puts his spirit inside of us, he marries up to our spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. We become one with him.
Amen.
Right?
Yes.
Praise God. So if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus was put to death in the flesh, but quickened or made alive by the Spirit. By the Holy Ghost. When we talk about this capital S up here, we're not talking about the human spirit, but we're talking about the Spirit of God, this Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, if his Spirit is living inside of you, not just who was it? Was it you preached that the other day? But not just temporarily, not just being moved on. It was either Jeremiah or John when they was preaching. You know, we don't want the Lord just to move on us. We come to church, you know, a time or two and we feel the Spirit of the Lord. That's all wonderful and good. God does that because he loves us. But God doesn't want to just brush his Spirit upon us. He does that to encourage you and to help you and to let you know he loves you and he cares about you. But God wants to take up residency.
Amen.
Inside of us.
That's
amen.
Right.
He wants to be married up to our spirit. And that won't happen until we give ourselves to him. Amen. He wants to be in us and live in us and dwell in us. He wants to be our God. He wants to be our Lord. He said, I'll be their God and they'll be my people. That's what he said. He said, come out from amongst them. Touch not the unclean thing. He said, I'll receive you. I'll be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. Then it says, having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us, we need to do something. Let us cleanse ourselves. You say, well, Jesus cleanses us. Yeah, he cleanses us from our past sins. But our future, amen, depends on us cleansing ourselves,
amen,
from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God.
Amen.
Jesus takes care of sins past, or in other words, sins behind us. But we need to turn and walk with him. Amen.
Yeah.
And he said, if you will do that, I will walk in you, I will dwell in you,
amen,
I will be your God, and you will be my people.
Amen.
Amen. So if the spirit of him that raised Jesus Jesus was crucified. He was put to death in the flesh, but he was made alive. He was made, he came back to life, didn't he, the third day. He was made alive, quickened by the Spirit. If that Spirit dwells inside of you, he also that raised Christ from the dead shall quicken or make alive quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Now, you can look at that, and oftentimes we talk about the catching away of the, you know, of God's people. There's coming a day. I don't know the day or the hour it's going to take place, but there's coming a day when a trumpet's going to sound.
Amen.
Amen. There's going to come a trumpet sound. The Lord's going to sound at the last trumpet, says. And I take it that that's the seventh trumpet. If you want to know when Jesus is coming, it's around the seventh trumpet in the book of Revelation. That's around Armageddon sometime. Okay, I don't know the day nor the hour. You know? Praise God. But the catching away is going to, the trumpet's going to sound, the Bible says, and the dead in Christ, those that died in the faith, the dead in Christ shall rise first, because they're buried, aren't they?
Yeah.
Amen. The dead in Christ shall rise first. They're going to be given an immortal body. Amen. Their spirit has already departed to be with the Lord, but they're going to be given an immortal body. A body, it may have been turned back to dust. It may have been burned, you know, in the crematory. But it's going to be given an incorruptible body.
Yeah.
Likened to his glorious body. Okay, the dead in Christ is going to rise first. Then we, Paul even looked for it in his day. I guess, because he said, we which are alive, the Christians that are alive at the second coming of Jesus, we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord. We're not going to prevent. It means to precede. We're not going to go before them. We're not going to precede those that have died in the faith. But we're going to be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. Amen. Praise God. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. At this point, whenever it's going to take this mortal putting on immortality at that time, right?
Yeah.
And you know what's going to, what the Bible says, it says God's going to raise us up by his own power. The same way he raised Jesus from the dead.
Yep.
These bodies are going to be transformed to be like Jesus' glorious body.
Yep.
Come on. There's going to be people walking the earth whenever Jesus comes. There's going to be some of them, you know, that's walking the earth. There's going to be some that's already passed. But both of them are going to be changed to incorruptible.
Yep.
And it's going to take that to be caught up in the air.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to be made likened to his glorious body. And it says, anybody that has this hope in them, you know what they do?
Purifies
themselves, even as he is pure. You know what they do? They get out of the life of sin. They quit being the servants of sin, and they become the servants of God, and they have their fruit of the everlasting life. Amen. Oh, you're living for Jesus, don't you?
Amen.
So that when that day takes place, amen, if the spirit of him that raised Christ from the dead, it will also quicken me.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Now that's Paul. It can't imply that. But in this scripture's context,
amen.
If you read the whole chapter, what that is saying is if Jesus, his spirit, is actually inside of you, he that raised that man Jesus from the dead will also raise you from a life of sin.
Yeah.
Amen.
It will bring you out of a life of sin.
Amen.
It will resurrect you, because you know what? While you live a life of sin, you're dead in trespasses and sin.
Amen.
Amen. Whenever the prodigal son left his father's house, he was in father's house. Amen. And he got the itch to go and be worldly and wild.
Yeah.
He said, Father, give me that which is, belongs to me. And he took his father's goods and he went, and the Bible says he wasted them on riotous living. He was partying.
Yep.
He was doing everything and anything he wanted to do in the flesh. His brother mentioned that he'd been with harlots.
Yeah.
Come on, he did some mighty ungodly things. But while he was out there, you know what? He hit rock bottom. That was the best thing that ever happened to him. It really did. Because whenever he hit rock bottom, the Bible says he was out there eating the stuff that the hogs ate. Yeah. Amen. And while he was out there, he was so far from where he had been. While he was out there, the Bible says he came to himself. Amen. Oh, that's what happened to me. I was out there, and I came to myself. God did that work in my life.
That's right.
I saw my need of God. That prodigal son saw his need of God. Amen. And he was so far away. He was so far away. But when he came to himself, he began to reason, and he said, you know what? My father's servants, they are taken better care of, and here I am. I'm starving to death, eating what these hogs eat. I'm filthy. I've lost everything. I've squandered everything. And look at the shape I'm in. He finally saw himself, didn't he?
Yep.
Come on. He saw his condition, and he didn't blame it on nobody else. He knew he got himself there.
Amen.
He did. He got honest. He said, you know what I'll do? I'll go back to my father, and I'll say, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. And he said, I'm not worthy. God loves humility, doesn't he? I'm not worthy to be called your son anymore. But he was still his son.
Yes, he was.
Come on, he was still his son.
Yes,
he was a backslid son. He was a son, a wayward son. Praise God. But he said, you know, I don't deserve to be called your son, but just make me as one of your hired servants. Amen. And the Bible says, whenever the father looked, he saw him afar off. He wasn't nowhere near where he needed to be. Come on.
Amen.
And there's a lot of people out there that's nowhere near where they need to be with God. But they got a repentant heart. Come on.
Amen.
And they're wanting to come to God. Amen?
Amen.
And you know what? The Father wants them to come.
That's right.
He wants them to come. They may be a mess. They may be all kinds
Amen.
Of dirty. Amen?
That's right.
But he saw them afar off. And he said, the Father ran to him as dirty as he was. He wasn't afraid to just embrace
Amen.
Him and hug him and kiss
Amen.
Him. Amen. He said, kill the fatted calf. Bring the best robe and put it on him. Amen. Praise God. Amen.
Amen.
Put the family ring on him. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. You know what? He was so glad to just get him rejoined. Amen.
Amen.
To righteousness and to out of that life that he was in. Amen. And the older son got mad because he thought he'd been home all the time.
Yeah.
He got mad. He got, when he saw all the things, he come up to his dad and said, you never killed for me a fatted calf. This son's went out and spent your living on riders, living in blah, blah, blah. All the stuff he began to say. And he said, it was needful for us.
Yeah.
To rejoice.
Amen.
Because this, my son, was dead.
And is alive.
And is alive.
Amen.
Amen. When he lived a life of sin, he was a walking dead man.
Amen.
And when we live a life of sin, we are walking dead men. But when we come back to Father's house, amen.
Amen.
I want you to know we become alive.
Praise
amen.
Jesus.
Come on.
Praise
we
the
become
Lord.
Alive in yes. Jesus. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. It doesn't happen way down the road. We become alive. Amen. Well, we got Jesus. If the spirit of him that raised Christ from the dead dwells in us, we don't continue to live that life out of sin. We come out of that life of sin and we walk with Jesus. Amen? And in walking with Jesus, yes, we're on the path of the holiness of God. Amen?
Amen.
It is the highway of holiness. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. We don't live that, we don't become servants to sin anymore. If you want to be a servant of sin, you're going to get the wages of sin.
Amen.
But if you will serve God, become a servant to God and serve righteousness and godliness, the things, everything that's of God. Amen?
Amen.
He said, again, if you come out amongst them and separate yourself, amen, not isolation, but come out of sin.
Amen.
Amen. He said, I will receive you.
Amen.
And I'll be a father to you. Amen. Let me tell you something. Praise God. The prodigal son, praise God. Whenever the Father said, he said, bring the best robe and put it on him. Amen. And he had done, went out and done some very foolish things. Praise God. You know what he did? Father put the best robe on him. Praise God. I believe that depicts, listen to me. I believe that depicts whenever we are out in sin, we get all filthy. But when we come to Jesus, amen, and we repent, we are, there's a, he puts a wedding garment on us. Amen?
Yep.
You know what that wedding garment is?
His righteousness.
It's his righteousness.
Right.
It's not our righteousness. Amen. It's his, he robes us. Amen? Amen? He just come out of a life of sin. He just come out of a life of darkness. Amen?
Amen.
He didn't wait a long time to get that robe put back on him. Amen? God, the Father was ready to put it right back on him.
Amen.
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 Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus.
She's talking. Praise God. You know what, though? Listen to me. Hear something about that story. You read it? The Father never went after him.
That's right. But he did need him.
He did, but he knew he had to wait till he came to himself.
That's right.
He had to have that moment.
Yes.
If he had not had that moment, he would never come. He would have fought it. He would have fought it. He would have fought Father. You know, because he was rebellious. It was till he had to come to that place of brokenness.
Yes.
Amen. And when that place of brokenness came, amen, and that honesty in his heart, amen, humbleness, you know, amen. He never quit being Father's son.
Yeah.
Amen. But he was. My son was lost.
Amen.
He was a lost son, but is found.
Amen.
And that's the way we all become. But we need to become the servants of righteousness, folks. Listen to me. Don't just hear about Jesus and continue on in your sinful life. Don't let the, don't, I didn't get into the scriptures, but I had them in my notes. That's being deceived. That is deceiving oneself. Amen. Jesus warned. He said, you know, about his second coming. He said, beware of false prophets. Amen. That come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they're ravening wolves. You'll know them by their fruit. Amen. Amen. Praise God. A person's not doing you any favors when they tell you you can live the life of sin and it doesn't matter. It does matter. It matters very much to God. He wants us to live for him.
Right.
You hear me? He wants us to depart from sin and live unto God and produce fruit unto holiness, because the end of that is everlasting life.
Amen?
Amen. Praise God. Everlasting life. I want everlasting life, don't you? You want everlasting life? I want everlasting life. Praise God. Jesus came and gave his life so that we could have everlasting life. Amen. I want to keep you. Let's stand. Praise God. Live for Jesus.
Amen.
Everybody say, live for Jesus.
Live for Jesus.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Lord.